Mighty Sounds Festival, and we're chilling in the tour bus with the guys from Sick of It All.
Hey!
Chilling being the right word, because it's actually kind of cool in here.
Because it's AC in here, outside we get like 50 degrees, but...
Yeah, it's brutal out there.
Yeah, perfect place to be here. So guys, you're out there doing music for almost 30 years, I guess?
Yep. Next year. Years. Next
like
year
I'm 25,
30.
So that's pretty... So that's huge.
Me too.
And you still play with such energy, you know, you're still on the road. What drives you to do this?
Just to be good. You know, not to be a fuck up, not to be a hack job. You know,
not to disappoint.
Yeah.
You got to bring it to get it. You know what I mean? If you don't bring the impact, the people aren't gonna give it back to you. You gotta come heavy or stay home.
Okay. Guys, what about the hardcore scene? Because you were out there in '80s in New York City when there was, I don't know, the new subculture was formed out there. How do you think hardcore has changed or evolved after those 30 years?
It's gone a lot of different ways, you know. People have different ideals about it now. I mean, when we started, it was just, you know, for fun and do it, and it just snowballed into this. Now people say, oh, I'm going to start a hardcore band so I can tour the world and blah, 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 you know.
And you can.
You can
actually do that and make a living from it if you're a good band. So that possibility exists now. And it has existed for a long time, to be honest. Like, when we first started out, we didn't really have that idea that we could make this a career. It just happened.
We were just doing what we liked. It was like one foot in front of the other. You didn't think of the big picture because it didn't really exist.
So, there was no, big marketing scheme behind anything.
It was just play the next show that's in front of you, right? That was it. Yeah. Just enjoy the next show. Oh, we're going to play in Boston. We're going to play, oh, we're going to Florida for 5 shows. Everything was a thrill. First time you go to Europe, it's a big thrill. So it was just, you know, step by step. I think now the scene is it's broken off into a lot of smaller little sects, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Where before everything, sects just means subcategories, but it used to just be one collective. You had all different types of music, from everything from heavy metal to punk rock to ska to oi, all mixed into one scene, heavy metal, everything.
And it was better that way, being so split up.
Way more communication.
Having more, you know how this festival has a whole bunch of different styles of music? Yeah. A regular show at CBGB's would be kind of more like this than it would be nowadays, where you would have only bands, like if a Hatebreed style band was playing, all the other bands would be a Hatebreed style band.
Yeah.
And for some reason, people like that.
In America,
to me, that's not a desirable trait of a show.
Europe kept it a little more diverse, you know. And I think that's really good. The fact that, you know, different crowds within the same genre get pulled together. It's communication, you know. It's really what it's about. It's about people coming together.
Yeah, it's not about what genre are you playing, you know.
All the division. Division is the trick. To make everybody, go
fall
against each other and fall in line. Yeah. You know, divide and conquer. It's the oldest thing in the world. So I think that this music is communication, you know? So it's good to have it as open as possible.
Your last record, The Last Act of Defiance, was released last year. I would like to talk about the title, because it could be perceived two ways. It could be The Last Act of Defiance before victory or before defeat. Or that's how I see it.
Yeah, that's pretty much.
How did you mean it?
That's pretty much what it was. It's like, you know.
Yeah, you like the two parts of
You could make up your own idea about it. You know, a lot of people thought we titled that so we were that. Oh, this could be their last record, blah blah blah. But nah, it was just a cool title. And like you said, it could be the last act of violence before our victory or before the defeat.
People get too caught up in what's happening in the world, and it's terrible what's happening. But free will is the ultimate decider. You know, even if you're in chains, you can still have your mind be where you want it to be to some degree. You understand what I mean by that?
Yeah,
free your mind.
Yeah, free your mind. You know what I mean? That's really what it comes down to. You know what I mean? Yeah. It's all perspective.
That's the main message you wanted to send out. Because that was my next question.
That's what I'm saying. I don't know if that's the main message collectively, but what he said pretty much describes the title. It's open-ended. In other words, just my interpretation of it is that, you know?
Yeah. So the main message... There is any.
Yeah, wherever the world's pulling, ultimately you control you, even if you're in chains. You still control where your head's at.
I hear what the guy's saying.
Death to tyrants! Death to Satan! Death to Satan!
last record. It was the first single you released, I guess.
Yeah.
You did very well. It was very well acclaimed. I will quote now. We did not choose this. Passion drove us to it. Hardcore is our life now. Born to walk on the road less traveled. That's kind of passionate and personal. Have you enjoyed walking on those roads less traveled? Or
of course.
Okay. It's been, you know, we've been able to make music our life. That's it's so rare, especially, you know, when you see people that are really musically talented and all they end up doing is like working at a music store, yeah. You know, and it's such a shame to see that when it's possible, even for people of limited talent like ourselves, to actually make a living doing this. So we've always been very kind of conscious of how lucky we are.
Yeah. And, it, you know, the road less travel part is going to, you know, it was a scary thing. We didn't know that we could make, like we said before, we didn't know we could make a living at it. And there were times when we would go out on tour and it would be very scary. You didn't know what was going to happen. But we chose to do this instead of, like a lot of our peers who, when they were successful a little bit, and they're like, well, it's time, I got to go to college and get a career because, you know, I can't make music for the rest of my life. We just ended up doing it, you know.
Yeah, it's just, there's a certain sense of freedom involved in doing what you wanted to do as a kid, yeah. What you enjoy doing, you do now, and you're not really bound to anybody else as far as work is concerned. It's
and not harping on the future so much. There's a lot of people that freak themselves out, even though they have this, all the same opportunities as we did to make this their life, and they decided not to because of their own fear of what the future would hold.
You know, 2.5 kids, a dog, a house in the suburbs, all of that stuff can make you bound to an idea that can really mess you up.
And you can still get it by playing music
exactly.
Anyway.
Exactly. There's nothing wrong with
the idea. The only problem is there's no retirement plan.
It's the fear of getting there is the problem, you know? Yeah, there's no retirement plan. You know what I mean? Yeah. You got to make your own retirement plan, whatever that may be.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's cool. I love that everybody could have that optional opportunity. Everybody's got that opportunity, but it's not easy, right? And you guys did very well. You're doing it for 30 years. That's good.
Thanks.
What would you have been doing if you weren't in sick of it all?
It's hard to say. I was working in graphic arts in a rug factory, and I could have stayed there. I got really high in the position there. My position there was really, but then they went out of business like 10 years ago. What would I do then? You know, have to go start all over, learn computers, whatever the hell it is.
Who knows? I never did really well unless I was very interested in something. The only things I excelled in were things that I was passionate about. If I had to go work in an office for somebody, I was a real fuck up when it came to stuff like that.
Yeah.
I
didn't, to go on a
I
killing
didn't enjoy
spree.
It at all. Yeah. So I'm one of those people, you know, technically I'm lazy anyway,
one of those
but
guru
I'm not.
Guys.
When I love something that interests me, I'll push 200%. It's just if you put me in a position that I don't care about, you're not going to get much out of me. Yeah.
Craig would be a guru somewhere.
Nah.
look, he's wearing a positive color. Yep. You know,
right, right. Makes me happy. Makes you happy too. You're happy now.
I might have been in the music industry in one way or another. I don't know exactly where, because I did try it out for a little while, and I don't know. There's a lot of things about the music industry that could bum you out.
Yeah, but if that hadn't been music, you wouldn't be in the music industry. We're saying if music didn't really exist in your life, think about it.
Yeah, but no, I mean,
stripped away from you.
Music was always a passion of mine, so that's why I figured try out working at a record label, and I did for a little while, and it was okay, but it wasn't as satisfying as playing shows and having people applaud what you do.
We'd all probably be involved in music then if you're not taking music out of the equation. It just wouldn't be like it is now.
It wouldn't be being a band.
No, I'd probably be working.
I think I'd be involved in another way with music.
Maybe working construction or sewer workers.
I'd
be a millionaire. I'd be a millionaire in the biggest band in the world. Except these guys. Look what they did to me, huh?
What do you listen to nowadays, or in your class, or
a lot of different stuff.
Everything. I put my, when I drive my car, I put my iPod on a
random shuffle,
and everything comes up. I find myself liking R&B a lot. I listen to the bass lines and figure them out, like the old Motown stuff, because it's really good bass playing.
When I drive around, that's mostly if my daughter's not in the car, she'll listen to whatever I play, but she likes to listen to a lot of like kid pop music. But she likes that. If I put on Sick of It All, she shakes it. If I try to sing along to her kid pop song, she goes, Daddy, you sing good for your music, not this music. But when I drive around, I play mostly, there's an oldies station that goes from the 50s through the 70s. And it just reminds me of when a kid drive around my dad's car. So I just listen to that stuff. But at home, I listen to a lot of, you know, different punk, hardcore, old, new.
Yeah. She's probably going to grow up into a hardcore kid, yeah.
We'll see. She likes it,
yeah,
you know.
Yeah, she's too happy for that.
How old is she?
She's 5, yeah. She's here today. She's going to watch the show. She keeps telling me, I might not watch your whole show, Daddy. I want to stay on the bus. She loves the bus. It's like a new toy.
Guys, after you finish this, your summer festival session, what's next for you?
We're coming up with ideas for next year. Is our 30-year anniversary. So we're going to try to figure something out. We got to come up with a good set for touring. We got to come up with a good tour.
In the fall, we go to Southeast Asia and Australia.
Yeah.
So that's like the next like proper tour that we're going to do. That's like 3 weeks long. And then, you know, so as a part of that, we're going to China for the first time, which is new territory for us. We've been around for 29 years, but that's
never been to China before.
Never been to China. So we're going to hopefully get in the country and hopefully play a couple of shows.
It should be good. So guys, yeah. We did play Hong Kong, but it's not really China.
Well, not really, but close enough.
Guys, thank you very much for the interview.
Thank you.
Thanks, man.
Thank you.
With the hardcore legends.
Thank you for the interview. Very nice. Thank you.
Thanks, bud.
See you later.